Dumont once said of his passion for music, you feel he could squeeze a tune out of a Mars bar.
He's flown in on wings of song from Switzerland, bearing with him only his 18-carat gold flute and his extraordinary talent.
I've only got to say that he plays the flute, and you'll know who it is. But for any of you who may have been living in Mars for the last 3 years, I must tell you, ladies and gentlemen, it's Mr. James Galway.
My background in music began with listening to my mother play the piano, and I used to play in a flute band, and it gave a beautiful harmony. Every Tuesday and Friday, we got indoctrinated into this sort of classical music, and then I discovered they played it on a third program. So I used to look every week at the Radio Times to see who was playing the flute this week, and if nobody was playing the flute, I was really hopping mad, I tell you, at the BBC. I remember playing the Top of the Pops with Tony Blackburn. He got my name wrong. He said Galway instead of Galway. I hope he's watching this.
This one was a big hit for John Denver. In fact, it went to number one. It's called Annie's Song. It's a beautiful new instrumental version out by James Galway, which I want you to hear right now.
Thank you. A lot of people think that because I play any song, it's just a sort of quick way to make a buck. Well, it's just as difficult to play any song as it is to play the slow movement of the Mozart D major concerto, because you have to apply your whole self to doing that. You have to apply your mind, your musical interpretation. Intonation problems are the same. The color of the tone. You have to, with these tunes, you have to figure out a good octave to play everything in and things like this. So there is a lot of work goes into these things. We don't just get up and play the piece.
Working with Val was one of the great pleasures of my life. He is such a fun guy and serious. When it comes to the music, he's really in there. But aside from the music, before and after, it's a laugh a minute.
Well, Jim, it's lovely to see you. May I say that?
Nice to see you too, and you may say it.
And you've got a cold.
I have. I always have something wrong with me on your show.
it's amazing. Now, last time, what was it, Jimmy?
I had a broken shoulder.
That's right. The time before that, he was in a wheelchair.
Dueling banjos was one that we played, and it's originally for two banjos. Boy, that was a quick one, wasn't it? and we did it with piccolo and guitar, because we didn't have two banjos handy.
Here we go, Jimmy, get ready. This first bit is rather tricky. Okay. Perfect. We do it again.
Okay.
Got it now. Listen.
Look at this, no hands.
Oh, brilliant!
This is my fourth visit to Japan, and on each occasion the schedule was so frenetic that all I actually saw was the inside of concert halls. This time I was determined to get out and about as much as possible and to play some music with Japanese musicians and to see something of the Japanese themselves.
I remember very well filming in Japan. That was a special thing, and I took several days and we went to several locations. One of the locations was a Zen monastery where they all played this shakuhachi.
The shakuhachi plays a big part in Japanese life in two ways. In one way, it is the old traditional flute of the Zen monks. And in the other way, it's the modern instrument of the Japanese kids. And they all play contemporary music. At this monastery we went to, the first thing which impressed me was the two masters who played. They didn't specially prepare. I mean, they didn't practice 4 hours to be filmed by the BBC. They simply got out their shakuhachis. We said, would you play something? And they said, delighted. And they, quite correctly in my opinion, they said a prayer. Not a prayer in the form that we know it, but it's acknowledging the fact that their music is coming from somewhere else.
Thank you.
The Chieftains are old friends of mine, and when they're on tour in Switzerland, we always get together. You see, the reason that I think that people should keep in touch with folk music is that it gives you a national identity. If I were to play you 10 bars of Boulez or Stockhausen, for example, I'm sure there's a lot of people who wouldn't be able to tell A, if it was Stockhausen or Boulez, and B, the nationality of the fellow who wrote it.
If I threw my wallet up, I'd never be able to catch it.
When I'm playing Danny Boy, I sing the words in my mind. It's like a prayer in music, and it really brings a lot of people together. I play it nearly every concert, whether it's with an orchestra or piano. Thank you. the tin whistle came into my life through a shop around the corner called the Wendy. And they had a thing called a lucky dip. And every Friday we would go and spend our money getting a lucky dip. And in one packet of lucky dip was a tin whistle. And that set me off on this because it was basically the same fingering as the flute that I played.
You've got some penny whistles, haven't you?
Yeah.
Yeah, you always carry these around with you. This is, the second instrument you started on, isn't it?
Yes, the first one was a mouth organ. The mouth organ was all the rage, you know, Roy Rogers and Trigger and everything like this.
Yeah,
and...
Right. The Sons of the Pioneers and all that bit, yeah. You still practice on, well, you don't have to practice on it, do you, I suppose?
Well, yeah, I'm thinking of learning a couple of new tunes.
What tunes do you know?
Well, this is just a sample of what I used to do when I was a kid in the street. We never learned the names of these tunes even, you know. And my dad used to tell me all the time, listen, when you're practicing a flute, use the correct fingering. And this really bugged me because I like to use all sorts of funny fingering for different sort of sounds on the flute, you know.
Yes.
And so I agreed with my dad I would learn the correct fingering, but this is what I used to do just to show him that I really didn't agree with him, you know. So I used to do something like this.
Cleo was great. She was so versatile in her music making. And I remember doing one piece called Anyone Can Whistle. And I had to play the piccolo. I hated playing the piccolo. So I never practiced it. Don't tell anybody.
Well, that one is for Anyone Can Whistle. It's all so simple, slay a dragon, any old Greek. Easy. What's hard is simple, what's natural comes hard. So maybe you can show me how to let go, lower my guard and learn to be free. Maybe if you whistle, whistle for me.
I'm known as the man with the golden flute. Actually, I have about 17 golden flutes. I also have 5 platinum flutes, a number of wooden flutes, piccolos, and all sorts of other flutes that I've collected over the years. In front of you, you see 2 platinum flutes, they're the 2 white ones, and the one in the middle is a gold flute from a Danish maker, Mr. Brugger, and the other ones are made by my flute maker in Japan, Mr. Muramatsu. And this one is the famous one with the diamonds in it. Of course, diamonds make you play better.
I got these diamonds from the Argyle Diamond Company in Australia, and they made a present of them for me. There's a ring of champagne diamonds and a ring of regular diamonds, and the same on the foot joint. People often ask me if gold makes a different sound, and I say it does. And of course, there are a lot of people who play silver flutes who say it doesn't. That's because they can't afford a gold flute to really make a comparison.
You haven't looked that young for a long time.
Oh, I forgot my glasses.
Thank you.
if I had to live with one composer, it would be Mozart. It's like he talks to you, you know, his music. It's wonderful. His music is like a conversation all the time. There's always a question and an answer. And always in perfect style.
Thank you.
Those guys, they're the fastest musicians I've ever worked with. They were so popular. And the actual fact, the first piece I played with them, I think it was on ocarina. And I bought an ocarina and practiced that. You see how the BBC enlarged my repertoire of musical instruments.
Lovely to see you again, Marla.
Nice to see you too. And do you know what? Since I last saw you, I've been so influenced by you, I've started practicing the mouth organ.
You didn't.
I must be one of your best students, I think.
How's it coming on? Good?
Well, I've got two with me. Have you got one?
You're going to play it twice?
Yeah, okay.
I've got one as well. Yes, I've got my little one.
Uh-huh.
Will we try a little piece together?
Why not?
I used to play the mouth organ as a kid. And as a matter of fact, I think the mouth organ that we had gave the measles to everybody in the street. And I didn't play it again until Val asked me. He called me up one day and he said, Jimmy, do you play the mouth organ? I said, yeah, at gunpoint. And he says, do you think we could do Amazing Grace? I said, sure. So I rushed out to the local music shop and bought about 5 mouth organs and different keys because I didn't know what key he was going to do it in.
1, 2, 3.
Such a wonderful host, and it came about through an inquiry to our office, and of course we snapped it up, went along and did it, and on the same program was Elton John.
On we pop to someone else who, like Elton, has dropped everything to be with us for our first birthday. He's flown in on wings of song from Switzerland, bearing with him only his 18-carat gold flute and his extraordinary talent, with the aptly titled, at least for this program, Pie in the Face Polka. Welcome, James Galway. Thank you.
program with Wogan. I was about to go to the festival hall and play there, and they had a big cake, and they offered me a slice of it, and I thought, God, all this sugar down the flute doesn't work. So I sort of declined.
Have some cake.
Well, I'm going to have some cake now. Right. Well, you do play all kinds of music, don't you?
Yes, I
I mean, you're a bit of a rebel, aren't you?
Don't let me interrupt your supper. No.
Well, I'm very glad you made the point, because I haven't had anything to eat all day. It's all right for you. You've had dinner.
Wrong.
You just told me.
No, I had a vitamin pill and a banana. Because I didn't fancy eating an apple, because when you eat apples, it's not good for playing the flute.
Blue Peter is very memorable. I began by playing The Flight of the Bumblebee because it's a favourite piece of all the kids. The ones who have been playing the flute for about a year, they think, I'm ready. I'm going to play The Flight of the Bumblebee. On one of my shows, I asked my brother George to come along, and he brought all his bunch of kids playing recorders. And the piece that we played with the kids was The Entertainer. And I thought it was brilliant, the orchestration, because we had these little ones playing small recorders, bigger ones playing bigger recorders. And the BBC got these shots when it was da 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 dee da dee da dee, large recorders. Da 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 dee da da dee da da da, small recorders. And these kids all concentrating, fit to bust, like I was too. Nowadays, I spend a lot of time teaching, and it's very important to me because I would like the younger generation to be able to play spectacular flute.
Now, in its 25th year, the Galway Flute Festival is held in a convent just across the lake from Jimmy's home in Switzerland. The connection between singing and playing, which Jimmy first discovered through his early influence Marcel Moyes, remains at the heart of Galway's teaching ethos.
When she's singing, oh, dee dee, ha, ra ra dee da ding, dee. It's not da ding ding. You see?
They look up to me as their idol, and they all practice the flute like mad, of course. I think it's important that they give these kids every chance to learn music.
You know, something like this.
I think in my flute playing, there has been a before and after since I started studying with him. So every time I have new difficulties to face, I go with him and he helps me.
Do you understand what I mean?
They have such great imaginations and they need to know how to open it up and how to apply it. Music is a sort of funny thing. There's no strict rule on how to do it. It's everybody tries to find their own way. Cover so many areas, like pop, folk, Japanese music, and you have to treat them with the same reverence, and I think therein lies the success of a performance.